I'm going to show you the different types of programming structures that are found in MATLAB. Go through a couple examples in this screencast. First of all, I wanted to introduce the operators and the precedents before we get into the programming. We have the order of operations would be the caret, which represents exponentiation. Then we have the negation or the unary symbol. And we have multiplication and division, plus and minus. Everything is read left to right. If you want to override something similar to other programming languages, you use a parentheses. Relational operators, if you want to see if something is equal to something else, you actually use two equal signs. Not equal to is a tilde, equal, and then you have less than, greater than, less than or equal to, greater than or equal to. Logical operators, the ampersand sign is for and. We have a vertical bar, which is above the backslash on most keyboards, that's or, and then we have the tilde, which represents not. The most basic selection structure is the one-way if. We have a flowchart where we come into some sort of logical condition. If it's true, we do something. Otherwise, if it's false, we don't do anything. We just move on. In MATLAB, this looks like just an if logical statements, and we end. A simple example of this would be this function I've set up here, which is sine squared. First of all, we calculate y to be equal to x squared. If x is less than 0, then we set y equals to negative y, so we carry over the sine of the original x into the square of that value. So the sine square of negative 3 would be negative 9, and that's where the if comes in. The second type of conditional is the if-then-else. This is different than the one way because you do something if it's false. So if the logical condition is true, you do something. If it's false, you do something else. This looks like if some sort of logical expression, else statements, end. An example of this is the friction factor depending upon the Reynolds number. So I've got a function friction factor, function of r. If r is less than 2000, then the friction factor is 16 over r. Otherwise, the friction factor is a different equation. And when we type these in for the two different ranges for the Reynolds number, we see that we get different answers depending upon the route that we take. Next, we have the multi-alternative, if then else if. We can have one condition. If that's true, we do something. If that original condition is false, then we have another conditional. If that's true, we do something. Otherwise, we keep going down and down. We're sort of skimming off the false answers here. It looks like if condition 1, then you do code block 1, else if condition 2, code block 2, and so on. At the end here, you have just an else. If nothing else is satisfied, then you do something, and that is optional. A good example of the multi-alternative if-then-else is thermocouples. So for example, we might have three different correlations depending upon the voltage from a thermocouple. Top one here, if we have a low voltage. Next, if we have a different range for the voltage, and then we have another correlation for a higher voltage value. If it's less than negative 8, we display an error. If it's greater than 69.55, display another error. So this looks like, as shown here, we have the function thermocouple. It's a function of voltage. And I've got if voltage is less than negative 8, we say out of range, voltage too low. Then we have else if voltage is less than 0. We have the first correlation, less than 42. We have a second correlation, less than 69.55. We have another correlation. And then we have an else, which means if none of those are true, we display out of range, voltage too high. And just two examples here. I have a in-range voltage here, thermocouple of 5.2, and it displays a temperature of around 95 degrees. Or if it's out of range, then it displays out of range, voltage too high. Next, we have the select case. We come into some sort of decision, and it's not really where we're looking at ranges. We're just sort of looking at discrete cases. So we either have, you know, like a menu, for example. It can be A, B, C, or integers, 1, 2, 3. This looks like switch, and then you have a expression, case, and then at the end, if you don't have anything else going on, you just write otherwise. I'm going to show you an example of this. I've got pressure is equal to input, enter pressure in PSI. The user is going to input a pressure, and then it asks, would you like to convert to kilopascals, bars, or atmosphere? You also notice, importantly, I have an S here at the end of my input. You have to do that if it's going to be a string. Depending upon what they enter as their units they want to convert to, we're going to have a different equation for the output. And we have something at the end which just sets x equal to the output units. Then I display fprintf converted. Pressure is, and I have two placeholders here, one for, so x is actually a vector of our output and the units. I have six digits here with two to the right of the decimal. And then I have my string here, which is the percent s is going to display the string in terms of units. So when I run menu, it's going to ask me for a pressure in PSI. I will do kilopascals. I press A, and then it says the converted pressure is 101 kilopascals. Next, we have the DoWhile, or the pretest loop. You just have while condition, you have code, and then end. An example of the DoWhile is shown here, where I set x equal to 20, k equal to 0, and I say while x is greater than 1.1, I'm going to take the square root of it, and then I also have this counter, this k, so I'm going to iterate through to determine how many iterations this goes through. And when I run DoWhile, and we see it comes out about 1.0981, and it's gone through five iterations of that loop. We have the DoUntil, or the post-test loop, where we're doing the test after the loop code. There's no real way to do this in MATLAB, but you can fool MATLAB into doing this just using a while. 1 and 0 are logical constants for true and false in MATLAB, so while 1 is always true. So this loop is going to keep going unless you break out of the loop. An example of this is shown here. We come into this loop with x equals 5, n equals 0, fx equals 0, and while 1. And if f of x is less than 2, we're going to break and we're going to end. I'm going to show you how we can debug this and watch what's going on. So over here in the workspace, I'm going to undock by clicking on this arrow. I'm then going to take the editor and pull it over so I can simultaneously see the editor and the workspace. Next, I'm going to click over here on the left and put a breakpoint, and then I'm going to click play. So as I press F10, or I can actually step here, we can look over here in the window and see what's going on. We see that x keeps going down. Our function value keeps going down because x is going down. At some point, our function becomes less than 2, so now it's negative 3, and then we break out of the loop, and we will display x. So here we display x as negative 2. Lastly, we have the count-controlled iteration, or the for loop. We start with some sort of index. When the index exceeds an n value, then we exit. It actually exits this for loop with an index value 1 greater than the end, but then MATLAB actually resets the down 1 to index equals end. So when the index is not greater than the end, we have a loop code, we increment the index, and we keep going. In MATLAB, the syntax looks like for index equals start colon increment, which is just 1 if it's left out, colon end, and then we have our loop code and we keep going. An example of the for loop, I've set up a vector here, x, n is the length of x, and then I'm declaring a temporary value here. Temporary is going to be the first component of our x vector. I'm going to do this for loop, I'm iterating from k equals 1 to n minus 1, and I'm saying the vector component of x is going to be the next component of x. So it's actually then going to reassign, and then at the end we're saying the last one is actually going to be temp, and the temp we stored as the first one. So all this is doing is it's iterating through every item of that vector and moving it up one spot in our vector. We can have a more complicated structure involving two for loops, and here we have nested for loops. We're basically summing this array. We start with the size of our array. We set the number of rows equal to the size of 1 because size will give us a vector of rows and columns. And we declare sum is equal to 0. You have to do this. This is sort of like in VBA dimming variables. And then we're going to go through for I equals 1 to n rows. For j equals n 1 to n calls, we're taking the sum is going to be the old sum plus the current array value aij. And then at the end, we display our sum. I've got an a array here, and I do sum array. It's going to go through those two nested for loops, and it spits out the sum of our array.